Just before we get started, I will say that this video is brought to you by Beardblaze. Some of you might have heard this before, but I've got another channel called Brainblaze, and that actually led to the development of this very product. Long story short, I made a joke about how YouTube is a beauty product, and a fan of that channel emailed me saying that shouldn't make a beauty product, but should make a beard product. Beardblaze makes a full, luscious beard a reality, solving all of life's problems with fine facial hair. Not a guarantee. What happened was the guy that I teamed up with, Will, sent me a bunch of samples that he mixed up in his lab. I rubbed them into my beard like some sort of guinea pig, and boom, I chose the best ones and we came up with a whole range. These are just two of them. There are many. I've used a bunch of different beard oils in the past. It just keeps the beard nice and like conditioned and soft and all the stray hairs nicely tucked in. And yeah, I just feel that what we made is better. Also, we made it in a decent sized bottle and we made it at what we feel is a fair price. You can go to beardblaze.com to check it out. And now today's video. In October 2016, shortly before the US presidential election, the Washington Post released a video, secretly recorded in 2005, of a private conversation between Donald Trump and Access Hollywood host Billy Bush. In a now infamous exchange, Trump explains to Bush how, as a rich famous man, women simply let him grab him by the In the face of the ensuing media frenzy, Donald Trump Jr. was quick to dismiss these words as merely locker room talk and two alpha guys in a thing. The idea of the alpha male is a pervasive one in modern society, evoking a domineering individual who fends off rivals and maintains their dominant position through aggression and maneuvering. The term is, of course, derived from the behavior of wolves, whose packs are defined by a strict hierarchy with the dominant breeding alphas at the top, betas and gammas in the middle, and omegas at the bottom. Only, no, they aren't. Contrary to popular belief, there is in fact no such thing as an alpha wolf, this idea being based on flawed observations of wolf behavior made over 50 years ago. Since then, researchers have discovered that wolf society is far more simple and peaceful than previously believed. But old ideas die hard, and the concept of the alpha remains firmly lodged in our popular consciousness, despite a concerted effort by the man who popularized the term to set the record straight. Many of the misconceptions regarding wolf behavior stem from the fact that, for much of recent history, wild wolves have actually been relatively scarce, having been hunted to near extinction in much of Western Europe and North America. As a result, most early research was performed on animals in captivity. Among the first to study wolf society in detail was the German behaviorist Rudolf Schenkel, who observed a group of 10 wolves in the Basel Zoological Garden in Switzerland between 1934 and 1942. In his landmark paper, Expression Studies in Wolves, published in 1947, Schenkel coined the term alpha to describe the breeding pair of wolves that he observed dominating the rest of the pack. According to Schenkel, by continuously controlling and suppressing all types of competition within the same sex, both alpha animals defend their social position. This position, however, was not fixed and could, under certain circumstances, be taken over by other wolves in the pack who then became the new alphas. Meanwhile, the other wolves were denied breeding privileges and observed a strict hierarchy of dominance and submission, ranging from betas, who acted as deputies to the alphas, down to lowly omegas, who were often the victim of bullying by the rest of the pack. In 1970, American biologist David Mech built upon Schenkel's ideas in his best-selling book, The Wolf, Ecology and Behavior of an Endangered Species, which was largely responsible for cementing the term alpha wolf in the popular consciousness. But in the years since that book's publication, researchers, including Mech himself, have discovered that the behavior of wolves in captivity bears little resemblance to that of wolves in the wild. In hindsight, this is hardly surprising, given that the pack observed by Schenkel was kept in an enclosure barely 200 meters square and was composed of random individuals placed together with no means of escape. In the wild, by contrast, wolf packs are composed not of multiple adult wolves, but rather a breeding male and female and their offspring. The younger wolves remain with the pack for 1 to 3 years before heading off on their own in search of a mate. These new breeding pairs then form their own packs, starting the process anew. The structure of the group is not one of alphas and betas constantly struggling for dominance, but of two pairs parents and their pups. As David Mack explains, thus calling a wolf an alpha is usually no more appropriate than referring to a human parent or doe deer as an alpha. Any parent is dominant to its young offspring, so alpha adds no information. Why not refer to an alpha female as the female parent, the breeding female, the matriarch, or simply the mother? Such a designation emphasizes not the animal's dominant status, which is trivial information, but its role as a pack progenitor, which is critical information. Indeed, the breeding pair largely use their dominant positions for the benefit of the entire pack. For example, when the adults kill a prey animal, they will ensure that the youngest pups are fed first. And contrary to the popular image of the entire pack hunting as a unit, in most cases it is the breeding pair who do most of the hunting. According to Barbara Zimmerman of the Inland Norway University of Applied Science, quote, "The pups are usually not involved. The pups are not good at hunting themselves either, so they are pampered by the adults. They probably learn a bit from watching their parents, and they may sometimes be on some hunts, but it seems like they are very bad at hunting when they leave the pack." Intergroup aggression, when it occurs at all, is mostly related to parents attempting to tame or teach their unruly pups. While nonviolent displays of dominance and submission are typically the cases of younger wolves begging food from older wolves. In fact, after studying a pack of wolves on Canada's Ellesmere Islands for more than a decade, David Mack reported that dominance fights with other wolves are rare, if they exist at all. During my 13 summers where I observed the pack, I saw none. Therefore, the hierarchy of wild wolf packs hardly ever changes, for the breeding pair remain together for life, while the older breeding age offspring can simply leave to form their own packs. All of this was suspected as far back as 1947, with Rudolf Schenkel speculating that wild wolf packs consisted of a monogamous breeding pair and their pups. But these ideas were ignored, for at the time, conventional wisdom held that wolf packs were composed of assorted lone wolves who came together in the winter to increase their hunting efficiency. This is why groups of captive wolves, like the one studied by Schenkel, were considered representative of their wild brethren. Further reinforcing the notion of alpha wolves and pack hierarchies was the phenomenon of pecking orders among chickens, first described in the 1920s by Norwegian zoologist Thorleif Skjelderup Ebbe. Skjelderup Ebbe observed that hens maintain social relations via pecking and form strict hierarchies, where each hen will only act aggressively towards those below them in the pecking order. According to Anne Muller Gabrielsen, senior research librarian at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology, quote, "The concept of the pecking order became very popular. It had great influence on the whole view of science at that time, at least in research that had to do with living organisms. It was seen as an underlying dominance principle that structures society and behavior." Indeed, the pecking order behavior was often misattributed to roosters rather than hens, reflecting the dominant male-centric nature read in tooth and claw thinking of the biologists of the time. Ironically, while studies of captive wolves in the 1930s formed the basis for the traditional alpha hierarchy model, more recent observations in the 1960s and 1970s revealed that even these groups do not behave as the theory would suggest. According to David Mack, quote, "This view implies that rank is innate or formed early and that some wolves are destined to rule the pack while others are not. Contrary to this view, I propose that all young wolves are potential breeders and that when they do breed, they automatically become alphas. Even in captive packs, individuals gain or lose alpha status, so individual wolves do not have an inherent permanent social status, even though captive pups show physiological and behavioral differences related to current social rank. Secondly, wolves in captivity breed readily, and I know of no mature captive individuals that failed to breed when paired apart from a group, as would be the case if there were inherently low-ranking non-breeders. However, there is one place where wolves do behave somewhat according to conventional alpha models. That's Yellowstone National Park. Wolves were reintroduced to Yellowstone in 1995 after an absence of 65 years, and consequently, their social structures more closely resemble that of captive animals than their wild European cousins. Unlike European wolves, Yellowstone wolves hunt in large packs composed of multiple family groups, with the breeding pairs observing an alpha-beta style hierarchy. However, this hierarchy is nowhere near as rigid as the traditional model would suggest, and changes in leadership, when they do occur, are typically carried out peacefully. For example, when one of the parents dies, another may take its place and add its own pups to the group. In such cases, a daughter from the new partner will sometimes take over for the original lead female and breed with her step stepfather. Certain packs may temporarily adopt lone male wolves, while in larger packs, where both the lead and younger females produce litters, the younger females remain subordinate to the lead female but retain control over their own pups. Such behavior is virtually unknown in European wolf packs, who typically chase away all unrelated outsiders. In light of these revelations, David Mech has worked tirelessly to overturn the misconceptions popularized by his previous work, writing numerous articles and trying to prevent the republication of his influential 1970 book. Unfortunately, he was unsuccessful, and the book remains in print to this day. And despite his and others' efforts to set the record straight, the notion of alpha wolves remains popular, with Mech estimating that it will be another 20 years before the narrative begins to shift. Still, there has been some progress. One area deeply influenced by the alpha wolf theories of Schenkel and Mech was the field of dog training, which originated in the military. According to Anne Moller Gabrielson, quote, "Once the concept of the wolf and its strict hierarchy was established, trainers were more likely to use punishments. It wasn't just that the dog was punished when it did something wrong, you had to show the dog that you were the alpha wolf all the time." But most of what has been published in books since 2000 is so-called positive training, which is reward-based dog training that uses the least possible punishment and no physical punishment, so there has been a very big change. So, in conclusion, wolves are far more sophisticated and peaceful creatures than many give them credit for, and anyone who persists in referring to themselves as an alpha, well, I direct you to the words of the great poet Inigo Montoya. You keep using that word. I do not think it means what you think it means. So, I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Don't forget to subscribe, and thank you for watching.